This is Duke University.
I'm very happy to be here. I just realized I've been to the University of North Carolina. I've never been to Duke, so this is an enormous pleasure. Thank you very much for inviting me. I hope you'll be as happy with me once I've finished my talk as you seem to be right now. I'm smiling right now. I should not be because I'm actually in mourning for the Chicago Cubs having lost the National League Championship Series in four miserable, extremely badly played games. I'm also a Mets fan, but I've been rooting for the Cubs ever since I moved to Chicago, and this was a very painful few days for me. I also shouldn't be particularly happy because the story I'm about to talk about this evening is not a particularly happy one. My topic is the 100-year war in Palestine. It will draw on earlier work of mine, including Brokers of Deceit, but it is based on new work that I'm beginning to do on a project that I really can't get going on because I'm the chair of the history department and I can't do anything else as long as I do that. So you all are gonna hear something that nobody else has ever heard before, and I'm eager to hear your reaction. Most of what Americans think they know about Palestine is wrong. This shouldn't be a big surprise. Many of their images of Palestine are derived from the Bible, which, as you all know, was written down millennia ago. Not a really good roadmap to the present. Even worse, these images come from fictional sources, like Leon Uris's multi-million-selling novel Exodus, or the Academy Award-winning Paul Newman film of the same name. If you talk to an audience much older than this one, people in their 50s and above, and you ask them, how many of you have read this book or have seen this movie, a majority raise their hands. It's an enormously influential work. Or their images come from defamatory sources, like Joan Peters' bestseller From Time Immemorial, or from biased sources like the mainstream media. Moreover, the focus and the basic referent of most things said about this topic is actually Israel and Zionism and Jewish history, rather than Palestine and the Palestinians. What most people are thinking about, what most people are concerned about, even if they are writing ostensibly about the Palestinians or about the conflict, is in fact these other things. A typical example of this is Ari Shavit's very successful book, My Promised Land. I gather he's coming to speak here soon, which is written from a very personal, it's a very well-written book. It's written from a very personal and a highly apologetic Israeli perspective, even though it purports to correct the historical record by chronicling Israeli maltreatment of the Palestinians. I think it's actually an understatement to say that most existing portrayals of Palestine in the general culture, whether we're talking about literary portrayals or scholarly ones or visual ones, movies and TV, do not reflect a Palestinian perspective. My son is a playwright, and he works with actors, and his plays feature Arabs. And so he looks for Arab actors. All of them tell him, without exception, that the only parts that they can get are as terrorists. Mm. There's lots of work if you look like or can play a terrorist. This is often other Asian Americans, South Asians, and other people of dark complexion who play these roles. But Arabs get these roles. They have the right accent. That's typical of the portrayals of a large swath of the Middle East in the American media, not just Palestine. The Palestinians have, in fact, largely been defined in the American public mind, mainly by those who wish them ill. If they recognize their existence at all, it is, in fact, an article of faith for many of their opponents that the Palestinians do not exist. This is repeated regularly by leading American politicians like Newt Gingrich or Mike Huckabee, and this canard is the central theme of Joan Peters' book, From Time Immemorial. Now, this is a book that, when it first came out, was widely praised by the good and the great luminaries like Elie Wiesel, Saul Bellow, Barbara Tuchman, Bernard Lewis, Alan Dershowitz, all loaded the book with praise. When scholars finally got a look at it, they completely discredited it. But the Peters book is in its 30th printing. It sells like hotcakes even today. On Amazon, you can see where it ranks. It goes up and down. But it's selling a lot still. Many more books like it have been published since then. And it was published, I think, in 1978. It's still out there. In a sense, the Palestinians have been elided from the historical record. They've been denied what Edward Said called permission to narrate. Other people speak for them, or other people purport to speak for them. Even when they are allowed to appear on stage, in the American context, this is often carefully balanced with the opposing point of view. And this could be Palestinian theater or Palestinian cooking or whatever. You have to have an Israeli or it's not balanced. What I wish to do in my talk this evening is to get away from what I think are distorted ways in which the history of Palestine is usually depicted, whether this is from an Israeli point of view, whether it's from a falsely balanced point of view, or whether it's in terms of a supposedly equal conflict between two more or less balanced parties. Instead, I would like to put forward an entirely different approach in order to illuminate the history of the past century in Palestine, not just as the Palestinians have experienced it, and not just as most of the rest of the world sees it, but as I think it really has to be understood. The perspective I'm proposing this evening goes as follows. The period since the Balfour Declaration of 1917 has witnessed what amounts to 100 years of war against the Palestinian. Now, this was a war with a unique nature. It was formally sanctioned and authorized by the great powers of the day at different times during the century and in different ways, but it was mainly waged by others. Britain took part in waging it for a period, but by and large it was waged by others, although it was proclaimed by the great powers of the day. A much distorted feature of this long war has been the Palestinians' continuing resistance to it. They did so against heavy odds, and they did so in resisting what amounts to one of the last ongoing attempts at colonial subjugation in the modern world. Now, taking this approach is not in any way to chronicle this history as one of the victimization of the Palestinians. I think instead it gives them full agency as a people resisting a long campaign to remove them from their land and to remove them from history. Nor is it to whitewash the mistakes of their leaders. As I wrote in one of the books I think Miriam might not have mentioned, published in 2006, a book entitled The Iron Cage, much of Palestinian history, in my view, must be understood in terms of the bad choices made by Palestinian leaders, albeit often in the most difficult of circumstances. What the people of Palestine have experienced as a continuous war against them since 1917 is still underway today. It is the same war. Different parties are engaged, it has different facets, it's waged differently, but it's the same war. It thereby constitutes a global anomaly. All other recent wars to uphold settler colonial regimes, whether this was in Algeria, whether this was in Southwest Africa, or other parts of Southern Africa, or elsewhere, finally ended with their defeat in the second half of the 20th century. This has not happened in Palestine. In Palestine, Israel has thus far been extremely successful in forcibly establishing itself, not just as a nation state, but as a colonial reality in a post-colonial age. And that involves masking that reality. It has done this while always assuming a false posture of beleaguered self-defense. The historian Patrick Wolfe, who writes mainly about Australia, as I think Australian himself, wrote the following, and I'm quoting Wolfe now. Settler colonies were, and then in brackets he says, are, premised on the elimination of the native societies. The split tensing, were, are, reflects a determinate feature of settler colonization. The colonizers come to stay. Invasion is a structure, not an event. In Palestine, that structure and the war that resulted from it are still ongoing in the present after 100 years. It is a war that understandably seems endless to the Palestinians themselves, as well as to those who are fighting. Now, I'm going to go through some of the repeated declarations of war in this long colonial campaign against the Palestinians. The first of these declarations of war was issued on November 2nd, 1917, on behalf of the British cabinet of Lloyd George by Foreign Secretary Arthur James Balfour. British troops were at that moment in the process of conquering Palestine. In fact, they occupied Jerusalem a few weeks later on December 9th, 1917. The Balfour Declaration and the League of Nations mandate that was granted to Britain on the basis of this declaration arrogated national rights in Palestine exclusively to Jews. They were the only people under the mandate who had national rights in Palestine. At this time, the Jewish population of Palestine constituted a tiny minority of the total population. The Balfour Declaration and the mandate thereby denied the national existence and the political rights of the vast majority of the country's people. Neither Balfour nor the mandate ever named the population which had lived in its own country for generations. If you read the Balfour Declaration, it doesn't say Arab, Palestinian. If you read the mandate, it doesn't say Arab or Palestinian. For all practical purposes, they did not exist for Balfour. The Balfour Declaration, and I'm going to quote something from Balfour to show exactly what he thought of them. For all practical purposes, the Balfour Declaration has been considered by historians in terms of various paradigms. Largely, in fact, in terms of either Jewish and Zionist or British considerations. The Balfour Declaration was, in fact, something else. It was a quintessentially colonial proclamation by the greatest colonial power of its era, of its intent to replace an indigenous people with another, whom it proposed to bring into existence on their territory. It's a very short document, the Balfour Declaration. It's a few lines, but that's what it actually says. For two decades, until the end of the 1930s, Britain carried out to the letter the terms of the Balfour Declaration and of the 1922 League of Nations mandate that defined British rule over Palestine by embodying and amplifying the terms of the Balfour Declaration. Under the mandate, Britain supported Zionist immigration and land purchase. It granted self-governing institutions and international diplomatic status to the Jewish minority while refusing self-government or diplomatic status to the Arab majority. In the Iron Cage, I have some amusing exchanges between the colonial secretary of the day and a Palestinian delegation in London, and he says to him, I'm doing you a favor by meeting you. You represent nobody. You have no standing. I'm just having you in to talk to you, but you are nobody, he was in effect saying. This is Lord Passfield, the colonial secretary of the day. Provoked by Britain's denial of their rights and indeed of their very existence, the Palestinians belatedly rebelled in 1936-39, briefly liberating some parts of their country in 1937, which the British took back with air power and so forth. The British Empire responded ruthlessly. This was the height of imperialism. They employed 100,000 troops and extensive air power to crush the uprising. In the process, the British killed, wounded, deported, or imprisoned 10% of the adult male population. Of Palestine, Arab population. They also confiscated huge quantities of weapons and exiled or jailed most Palestinian leaders. My uncle was sent to the Seychelles. The British loved to exile people to islands. Arabi Pasha was sent to an island. Zaghloul was sent to Malta. It was a habit of British colonialism. This war, 1936-39, waged by the British, constituted the brutal military implementation of Britain's original 1917 declaration of war on the Palestinian people. Now, we have to understand that the same dates, the same events, the same individuals can have a completely different valence for different people. For Israelis, Arthur James Balfour is a hero who has streets named for him in Israeli cities. And the promulgation of the Balfour Declaration in 1917 is an occasion for celebration in Israel. This, as you can imagine, is not the case for Palestinians. And I think you can understand this if you engage in a close textual analysis of the Balfour Declaration and of other documents from this era. The Balfour Declaration, for example, declares that there is only one people with national rights in Palestine, as I've said. And as I've said, this people, according to the Balfour Declaration, is the Jewish people. The Palestinians, who then constituted about 94% of the population, are described with the following words: the existing non-Jewish communities in Palestine. The declaration promised this vast majority of the country's population civil and religious rights, but not political or national rights. Now, a second key document that has to be looked at very, very carefully, each word has to be examined, is Article 22 of the Covenant of the League of Nations, which was promulgated in June 1919, and which was the basis of the mandate system. Article 22 described the Arab peoples of the regions of the former Ottoman Empire as independent nations whose independence can be provisionally recognized. This article of the covenant, which supposedly governed the entire mandate system, was subsequently interpreted by Britain, and consistently interpreted by Britain, to exclude Palestine. In other words, Palestine was not to be an independent nation. Palestine thereby did not benefit from the self-determination provisions of the covenant that eventually were applied to Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, and Iraq, other mandates under the League of Nations mandate system. So that's a second document. A third is a confidential memo which Balfour sent to the cabinet in August 1919, and which was only published many decades later, and in which he revealingly confided the following. I'm quoting Balfour now. Zionism, be it right or wrong, good or bad, is rooted in age-long traditions, in present needs, in future hopes of far greater import than the desires and prejudices of the 700,000 Arabs who now inhabit that ancient land. Analyze the words. Zionists have traditions, age-long traditions. They have needs, they have hopes. What do Arabs have? They have desires, they have prejudices. They currently inhabit that land. Balfour went on to add, in Palestine, we do not propose even to go through the form of consulting the wishes of the present inhabitants of the country. So that's a third document, which has to be analyzed very carefully. A fourth such document is the 1922 League of Nations mandate, which reiterated the Balfour Declaration and amplified its terms, thereby producing an operational plan for effectively eliminating the existing people and replacing it with another to be created in Palestine. Taken together and read closely, these statements of British and League of Nations and League of Nations policy in effect constitute what Israeli sociologist Baruch Kimmerling, the late Israeli sociologist Baruch Kimmerling, called politicide. This was implemented both by omission, the Palestinians are never mentioned by name in these documents, and it was implemented by commission, as these documents explicitly declare that Palestine is to be transformed into a Jewish national home. British leaders told Chaim Weizmann, the head of the Zionist movement in the 20s, Churchill, Lloyd George, Balfour, at a dinner somewhere, that they understood the term Jewish national home, as laid down in the Balfour Declaration, to mean a Jewish state. These documents furthermore faithfully reflect the wording of the original 1897 Basel Declaration of the First Zionist Congress, and they constitute a watered-down and more palatable version of the real Zionist objective of an exclusively Jewish state in Palestine, which Theodor Herzl, the founder of Zionism, privately confided to his diaries. As we've seen, the war which enforced these declarations of policy was initially prosecuted by the British military, with the main campaign taking place from 36 to 39 in response to growing armed Palestinian resistance. Now, the British weren't just doing this for their own strategic reasons. Vladimir Jabotinsky was the dissident founder of the militant revisionist wing of the Zionist movement, which is incidentally the trend that has dominated Israeli politics with few interruptions since 1997. In its current incarnation, the revisionist trend is the Likud party, the lead party in the current coalition, which won its latest electoral victory in March of this year. It's worth noting that Benjamin Netanyahu's father, the head of the party, Prime Minister of Israel, Netanyahu's father, whom he revered, was Vladimir Jabotinsky's private secretary. Jabotinsky was explicit. He wrote a book with this title in stressing the necessity of what he called an iron wall, I'm quoting, iron wall of British bayonets for the success of Zionism. He frankly recognized that, and I'm quoting now, in the history of colonization in other countries, every native population, civilized or not, regards its lands as its national home. This is equally true of the Arabs. Note Jabotinsky's frank use of the terms colonization to describe Zionist activity and the term the native population to describe the Palestinians. He wasn't fooling anybody. He wasn't trying to fool anybody. Jabotinsky concluded that overcoming the natural resistance of this population to their subjugation and displacement required, and I'm again quoting him, an iron wall, which is to say a strong power in Palestine that is not amenable to any Arab pressure. For two decades, Britain provided this iron wall, without which Jabotinsky freely admitted that Zionist colonization could not have been successfully pursued. Now, I'm done with the British. I have a few more things to say about them, but I'm basically done. I want to talk about other superpowers or other powers. The superpowers of the post-World War II era, the United States and the Soviet Union, were responsible for what amounted to two further declarations of war on the Palestinians. These were once again issued via the ostensibly neutral medium of an international organization, similar to the League of Nations. This time, it was the new United Nations. This brand new international body gave the patina of legal sanction to new violations of the inalienable rights of the indigenous Arab population of Palestine. The first of these two declarations came on November 29, 1947, via UN General Assembly Resolution 181 for the partition of Palestine. This was one of the few things that Truman and Stalin ever agreed upon. This resolution handed over the larger part of an Arab majority country, 90%+ of whose land was owned by Arabs, to its Jewish minority, about one-third of the population at the time, without the consent of that majority, and in violation of the principle of self-determination enshrined in the UN Charter, which had just been issued 2 years before. This led to the War of 1948-49, which devastated most of Palestinian society and led to the expulsion of more than half of the country's Arab population from their homes, about 750,000 or 800,000 people. They were never allowed to return. According to the partition resolution, alongside the Jewish state, whose establishment the resolution mandated, the Arabs were supposed to have a so-called Arab state. This two-thirds majority was to get less than 45% of what they saw as their own country. In view of these features, understandably, the resolution was accepted by the leading elements in the Zionist movement, and it was rejected by most Palestinians and by the Arab states, with the sole exception of Jordan. Arab disunity and the enduring weakness of the Palestinians after the British repression of the 1930s then contributed to the crushing defeat that was suffered first by the Palestinians themselves and was subsequently suffered by the four Arab armies that entered Palestine after the withdrawal of the British on May 15th, 1948, which is the date of Israel's establishment. Long before this happened, by mid-May of 1948, before Israel was established, mind you, hundreds of thousands of these Palestinian refugees had already been driven from their homes before the British left, before the Arab armies entered, many of them fleeing as news spread of massacres like Deir Yassin in April 1948, in which 120 people were killed after the village was conquered. In consequence of further massacres, in consequence of the subsequent defeat of the Arab armies, even more Palestinians were expelled, and most of the country was forcibly transformed into the new state of Israel. The destruction of most of their society has since been known by the Palestinians as a Nakba, or the disaster. The mainly Arab city of Jaffa, adjacent to the much larger, newer Jewish city of Tel Aviv, was overrun by Zionist forces and emptied of most of its Arab population of about 60,000 in April of 1948. Before the British left, before Israel was established. The same fate befell Haifa before May 15th, before the British left, as well as similarly sized Arab populations in Arab West Jerusalem, which with Jaffa, Haifa, and West Jerusalem were the three biggest Arab urban centers. In addition, smaller cities and over 400 Palestinian villages were similarly conquered and emptied of their populations. The UN partition resolution was a reiteration and updating of the 1917 declaration of war on the Palestinians in a different form, with different sponsors, in a different venue. United Nations rather than League of Nations. This time the patrons of Zionism were the United States and the Soviet Union rather than Great Britain. Once again, there was international cover for their action, that of the UN instead of the League of Nations. By now, Britain had been weakened by its losses in World War II and by the loss of India, while in Palestine it was being battered by the attacks of the Irgun and the Stern Gang. The British, therefore, had abandoned Palestine, thrown it into the lap of the UN, where the two superpowers now had predominant influence. Even though the creation of a so-called Arab state is mentioned in the partition resolution, I would argue that the sole genuine intention of the two powers that really drove this, the Americans and the Soviets, was to complete Herzl's colonial project and to create a Jewish state. They didn't really care about the Arab state. This endeavor was seen to be all the more urgent after the post-war revelation of the horrors of the Holocaust. In the end, all the United States and the USSR did was to complete Herzl's project. The rest, the idea of an Arab state, was in fact window dressing. This new state that was supposed to exist was quickly strangled in its cradle through the collusion of Israel, Jordan, and Britain. And this strangulation was met with indifference by the powers that had supposedly mandated the state's creation. The UN did absolutely nothing when an Arab state did not come into being and when its territory was taken over either by Israel or by Egypt or by Jordan. The actual acts of war against the Palestinians in this phase were carried out before May 15, 1948 by Zionist militias and then by the Israeli army with arms supplied by the two superpowers, marking a major shift from the previous phase when most of the warfare against the Palestinians had been carried out by the British. So that was the first superpower declaration of war. Their second declaration of war on the Palestinians was UN Security Council Resolution 242, issued in November of 1967, November 29th, if I'm not mistaken. I don't remember the date, doesn't matter. This resolution was supposedly meant to produce peace between the Arab states and Israel in return for the evacuation of territory that Israel had occupied during the 67 war. As you may have noticed, to this day, 242 has not produced peace. That's 1967 to today, 48 years and counting. Instead, as far as the Palestinians were concerned, 242 consecrated and continued the results of the 1948 war, both in terms of Israel's expulsions of the Palestinians and its territorial aggrandizement. These issues, which were the issues that were left by the 48 war, were not addressed in 242. 242 never mentioned any of these basic political issues, even those issues that had earlier been mandated by the United Nations, such as refugee return and compensation, which was the subject of General Assembly Resolution 194 in December 1948, or resolutions calling for Israel to give up some of its military gains during the 48 war. Instead, 242 referred only to a, quote, just settlement of the refugee problem. It thereby helped to efface further the Palestinians from their own country and from history. This resolution, which has become the universally accepted basis for a resolution of the entire conflict via what's summarized as a formula of land for peace, if you look at it carefully, doesn't mention the Palestinians as a people or even as a party to the conflict. This is true even though almost everybody, I mean, even Netanyahu, Israeli governments going back many years, accept that the Palestinians are a part of the problem. Treating this instead as a problem between Arab states and Israel, 242 refers, as I've said, just to the refugee problem. Like the Balfour Declaration, this Security Council resolution completely ignores the ongoing colonial process in Palestine, which was further exacerbated by Israel's occupation in 67 of the remaining parts of Arab Palestine, East Jerusalem, the West Bank, and the Gaza Strip. Security Council Resolution 242 thus constitutes another great power act of what Baruch Kimmerling called politicide, once again by omission. Now, after the crushing series of defeats of the Palestinian National Movement that started with the 1936-39 revolt and ended with the Nakba in 1948, it looked to many people as if that movement, and perhaps even the Palestinian people themselves, had disappeared. their traditional leadership under the discredited Mufti of Jerusalem, much in the news these days, for some of the wrong reasons it happens. But anyway, their traditional leadership under the discredited Mufti of Jerusalem had been shattered and dispersed. More than half of the entire Palestinian Arab population had been made refugees, and most of their country had been absorbed into Israel, with smaller parts taken over by Jordan and Egypt. The Palestinians seemed to have no voice, they seemed to have no central address, they seemed to have no champions. Partisans of this takeover of Palestine and the replacement of the country's indigenous inhabitants had long fervently hoped for such an outcome. In 1969, Golda Meir, I think this is just before, I don't know if she was prime minister at the time she made this statement. In 1969, Golda Meir told the Sunday Times of London categorically, I quote, "There were no such thing as Palestinians." Israel, she was prime minister, actually. Israel's prime minister thereby took the negationism that is characteristic of every colonial project to the highest possible level. For Meir, the Palestinians not only did not exist, they never had existed. Even as she spoke, however, events were proving that contrary to hope to the hopes of those who wished them ill, the Palestinians did still exist. After a hiatus that lasted for a decade, after 1948, young, middle-class, and professional Palestinians inside and outside their homeland had resuscitated their shattered national movement on a very different basis than that which had characterized the elite-dominated bodies that had been involved in Palestinian politics from 1917 until 1948. The 1967 war gave an enormous boost to these radical new groups, which openly advocated and practiced what they called armed struggle against Israel. An entire generation in Palestine was affected by the shock of this, and outside, was affected by the shock of this Arab defeat in 67, and by Israel's occupation of what remained of Palestine, as well as of Syrian and Egyptian territory. They were galvanized by the simultaneous reemergence of the Palestinian National Movement, represented by the rise of these armed groups, which later coalesced into the PLO. This rebirth constituted another episode of Palestinian resistance to the long war against them. It was a reassertion that the Palestinians existed in the face of constant denial. This is something that Israel not only proclaimed, as is evidenced by Golda Meir's statement, it is something that Israel had put into action via the demolition after 1948 of over 400 Palestinian villages whose population had been forced to leave and who were not allowed to return. I would argue that as grave as what Israel had done were the decisions of the United States, the Soviet Union, and other great powers through 242 to ignore the Palestinians entirely. It was against all of these denials and all of these slights that the Palestinians reacted, and indeed overreacted, in the 60s and 70s, violently asserting their existence via a series of spectacular attacks inside Israel and abroad. The response in the United States, in Israel, and in parts of Europe to the violence unleashed by Palestinian groups was intensely negative. The Palestinians were stigmatized as terrorists, a label that still attaches to them in some quarters. Paradoxically, this period was marked by the Palestinians' success in internationalizing their struggle beyond the confines of the Arab world. The PLO was recognized by the Arab League in 1974 as the sole legitimate representative of the Palestinian people, while garnering worldwide recognition, culminating in the opening of PLO missions in over 100 countries and the invitation of Yasser Arafat to speak before the UN General Assembly in the same year. This was the greatest international success in Palestinian history after so many years of non-recognition. However, and I'm getting back to the war here, the main response to the PLO's violence and to the organization's growing international profile was a ratcheting up of the war on the Palestinians. Israel took the lead in this war, launching attacks on resistance bases and refugee camps in Jordan and Lebanon from 1967 onwards, but many other actors were involved. And this is an important feature that is often underplayed. Another front in this war was Jordan, where during what the Palestinians called Black September, Jordanian troops in 1970 crushed the PLO and drove them out of Amman and other cities. A few months later, in the spring of 1971, Jordan completely expelled PLO groups from its territory. The next front consisted of a series of attacks on the Palestinian presence in Lebanon from 1968 onwards. From 1973, this included offensives against Palestinian refugee camps and PLO bases by the Lebanese army. In 1975, attacks by Lebanese militia groups. Starting in 1976, by attacks by the Syrian army. And this period concluded with major invasions of Lebanon by Israeli forces in 1978 and 1982. In all of this, the United States was far more than a mere onlooker. We actually have the foreign relations of the United States for some of this period, and it's very illuminating on how involved the United States was. Driven by Cold War imperatives and other motives, the U.S. actively supported these new phases of the war on the Palestinians, often with arms and other forms of assistance to Israel and other countries involved, but always acting through proxies. The United States did not act directly in any of these cases. Other powers were also engaged in this war on the Palestinians. In addition to countries like Jordan and Syria, in addition to Lebanese militias that I mentioned, a variety of other powers supported the Palestinians' opponents. These powers ranged from the Soviet Union and the Shah's Iran. The Soviets backed the Syrians. The Shah's Iran, Iran under the Shah, supported one of the major Lebanese militias. They included Saudi Arabia, which also supported Lebanese militias that were hostile to the Palestinians. They included France. They included many other powers. While the superpowers took these decisions and other powers went along, from 1947 onwards, most of the actual warfare against the Palestinians was carried out by the Zionist movement and its offspring, the State of Israel. In all of Israel's military operations, from the very beginning until the end, and in fact in the operations of the Zionist movement before the war, the backing of external powers was as vital to its success as had been the might of Great Britain before World War II to the success of Zionism. While the diplomatic support of the United States and the USSR was crucially important to Israel's victory in 1948 and to the passage of the partition resolution, the weapons both superpowers supplied Israel with were indispensable. Both the Americans and the Soviets sent weapons to Israel in 1948. Britain and British and French arms played a similar key role in Israel's 1956 and 67 wars. Israel won both of those wars essentially with British and French weapons. The French were meanwhile providing Israel with nuclear capacity, which it turned into, which enabled it to become the only nuclear power, military power in the Middle East. The unlimited provision of advanced U.S. weapon systems since the 60s has maintained Israel's unbroken string of military victories over both the Arab armies and the Palestinians. Now, I want to now talk about another phase of this campaign against the Palestinians, which took an ostensibly peaceful and diplomatic form, sort of like the mandate for Palestine in 1922, or sort of like 181 in 1947, or sort of like 242. They seem to be, you know, attempts to do something by the international community to resolve an issue. The key events during this phase were the bilateral 1991 to 93 Palestinian and Israeli talks in Madrid and Washington, in which I participated, as Miriam said, followed by negotiations in Oslo and elsewhere, in which I did not participate. In these different venues, the Palestinians were not, in fact, negotiating only with Israel or through a neutral American intermediary. They were actually up against two opponents, Israel and its close ally, the United States. The odds the Palestinians faced in these negotiations, as I mentioned in Brokers of Deceit, included not only Israel and its American patron, but also the autocratic Gulf regimes whose feebleness vis-a-vis their own domestic and external threats ensured that they remained pliable and durable and reliable allies and clients of the United States. These countries often put pressure on the Palestinians to accede to Israeli demands at the request of the United States. The odds the Palestinians faced, unfortunately, also included the incompetence, the lack of legal knowledge, and the ignorance of conditions inside occupied Palestine of the senior PLO officials who were involved in the Oslo Accords and in all the subsequent accords. These PLO officials accepted terms that had been rejected by the delegation that was mainly composed of people from the West Bank, Jerusalem, and Gaza, who had earlier been sent to Washington from 91 to 93. The delegation of West Bankers and Gazans and Jerusalemites proved more realistic and more hard-headed in dealing with the Israelis and the Americans than were the PLO officials who negotiated Oslo. I talk about this at great length in the book if you're interested, in Brokers of Deceit. In consequence of all these factors, and most importantly because of Israeli-American collusion, the regime that emerged from the 1993 Oslo Accords had the effect of denying Palestinian self-determination while allowing the expansion of colonial settlement and occupation. Oslo did not lead to peace. Oslo did not lead to self-determination. Oslo did not lead to an end of occupation. Oslo did not lead to an end of settlement. Oslo accelerated settlement. Oslo accelerated occupation and enhanced it. Oslo prevented self-determination. Oslo, in fact, had nothing to do with peace. It was designed in that way. It was designed on the basis of ideas that were first put forward by Israeli Prime Minister Begin in the 1978 Camp David negotiations. We have, from the Israeli archives, his notes and the notes of his chef de cabinet. We see what Begin said, what Begin wanted. That is exactly what Oslo produced. It was a template that had, in fact, originally been created by much, much earlier by Begin. The proof of what I'm saying, that this had not produced peace, is that the occupation went into its 49th year in June of 2015. Other proof is the growth in the number of Israelis living in Israel in illegal settlements in the occupied West Bank and in East Jerusalem. These numbered about 200,000 people at the time of Madrid, 1991. Today there are between 600 and 650,000 of them. So the settler population has tripled as a result of the peace process, which should legitimately be put in quotes, scare quotes. This so-called peace process, in my argument here, in effect constituted another phase in the American-Israeli campaign against the Palestinians. Its primary aim was to bring the Palestinians to accept their defeat in the long war that had been waged against them since 1917. I'm running out of time here. But I was going to talk about the most recent declaration of war in terms of what has happened around Gaza. I will skip that. I was going to say that this was combined with the continued suppression of Palestinians in the West Bank and East Jerusalem by Israel as it's furthered its unceasing colonization efforts in those two areas. And I want to say, and I will say this, that this suppression of the Palestinians by the Israeli occupation has taken place with the collusion and collaboration of the Palestinian Authority in Ramallah. Now, this is a body that was created by the Oslo Accords over 20 years ago and was mistakenly thought by some Palestinians to be the first step towards an independent Palestinian state. In fact, as I argue in Brokers of Deceit, the Palestinian Authority was always essentially intended by Israel to protect the security of its occupation and colonization enterprise. It is a body which has no sovereignty, no jurisdiction, and no authority except the authority that is allowed it by Israel. And even today, nearly two decades after its formation, in the current situation, today, October 2015, this authority continues its close security cooperation with the Army of Occupation and with the Israeli intelligence services by the admission of senior Israeli generals and the top figures in the Shabak and other intelligence services. So, what I've said this evening is that what has been going on in Palestine for a century has been completely mischaracterized in the American public understanding. In fact, this long war on the Palestinians, when seen in comparative perspective, should be understood as one of the last major colonial conflicts of the modern era, and is the last one devoted to the establishment of a colonial settler state. In this endeavor, the US and Europe in effect serve as the metropole, with their extension, Israel, operating as a semi-independent colony. None of this is less true, because over time, this war has also evolved into a national struggle between the indigenous Palestinian people and the Israeli nation state that has developed in Palestine. the conflict has thus developed a national aspect involving two peoples. However, the deceptive way in which it is often depicted as a tragic struggle over the same territory between two parties with equally valid competing claims has served to obscure its essentially colonial nature. The veiling of this basic reality also elides the fact that, like any colonial entity, Israel could never have been successful without the indispensable support of external powers, whether the old colonial powers of Egypt, of Europe, or the Soviet Union and the United States. In conclusion, notwithstanding the formidable coalition that has been waging this century-long war on the Palestinians, I would argue that this coalition has been trying to do the impossible. This is to impose a colonial reality in Palestine in a post-colonial age. This was as true of Balfour and Lloyd George, or of Truman and Stalin, as it has been of Clinton, Bush, and Obama, who have all extended full backing to Zionism and then to Israel at different times. Were the Palestinians as few compared to their colonizers as were the native peoples of this continent and of Australasia, and were we living in the 18th or the 19th century, there might have been a chance of successfully implanting a colonial settler society in place of the indigenous one. But in the words of the late Tony Judd, Zionism has, quote, imported a characteristically late 19th century separatist project into a world that has moved on. It has done this by exporting this European project into a non-European locale, which had a large existing population. In view of the persistent, stubborn resistance of the Palestinians to their displacement and to their erasure from history, such a project simply cannot succeed in this form in the 21st century. It cannot succeed even though the basically colonial nature of this encounter has been successfully concealed from most Americans and many Europeans who continue to extend support to the actions of Israel against the Palestinians. I leave you with this. I leave you with a question. How the true colonial nature of the ongoing struggle in Palestine can be made clear, and what that really means, and how these two peoples, the Palestinians and the Israelis, can transit to a post-colonial future in which they can both live in peace, and in which one people does not use massive external support to oppress and try to supplant the other. These are the questions that I will leave you with this evening. Thank you very much.